Peace, family. Welcome to African Esquire TV. I'm your host, Tony Cherie. The most pervasive aspect of colonialism is that the system left behind such a mark on our people that a lot of us don't see any world except for the one that was created for us. And in a particular way that this manifests is by the acquiring of things that actually should be looked at as belonging to the people collectively. Things like land, things like resources on the land that are pivotal to the country's economy. Those things get to be bought, those things get to be privatized, and the individuals who take advantage of the colonial situation or the post-colonial situation that is neocolonialism, those individuals are many times not even people of those countries who get to enjoy the benefits of the situation that has existed for hundreds of years. So we're going to focus on this issue in this video in regard to what happened in the country of Ghana. A port inside of a town called Tema was bought out by a French billionaire. His name is Vincent Bolloré. And we're going to discuss what exactly happened and why is it that African people are continuously inside of this situation? Because, like I said, we basically adopted the colonial systems when it comes to private property and private ownership. The French port to media conglomerate Bolloré Africa Logistics partnered with a Danish shipping giant, Maersk Ports Arm, APM Terminals, opened a huge profitable state-of-the-art container terminal at Ghana's Tema port in July of 2019. It's the latest link in a chain of 18 West African container terminals run by French billionaire and his partners. Africa Continental has uncovered how they won the right to build and run the new container port of Tema. A lifeline, not only for Ghana, but also for landlocked Burkina Faso and Mali through their 70% owned joint venture with the Ghana government, okay? It is a tale of intrigue based on the Westerners' lack of transparency and ethical discipline, according to the secret ministerial report by the Ghanaian officials, which Africa Confidential has seen and they've done their own research. The concessions Bolloré won from Ghana are similar to those which he obtained for his operations at the port of Lomé in Togo in return for financing a top political consultancy to help the country's president, Faure Gnassingbé, win re-election in 2010.
Billionaire Vincent Bolloré attended the inauguration of a port modernization project in Togo 4 years ago. Togo's president watched on as Bolloré explained how his company was boosting West African economies.
I am happy because this project has allowed many companies to come in and also created many jobs during the last 3 years. This project will also develop trade between Togo and its neighbors, which is synonymous with great wealth and employment.
The troubles were that the Bolloré Group's contracts to operate this container port in Lomé and another in Guinea's capital Conakry were won fairly. French investigators are looking into allegations that Bolloré's Havas advertising agency worked on the election campaigns of Togolese President Faure Gnassingbé and Guinean President Alpha Condé in return for winning the licenses. All parties have denied that there was any wrongdoing in the awarding of the deals. A statement from Bolloré's company, which runs ports and railways across West Africa, says the Bolloré Group formally denies that its subsidiary, at the time SDV Afrique, is guilty of any irregularities.
On February 26th of this year, Bolloré and two of his fellow executives admitted in a plea bargain to bribing the Togolese president in exchange for favors at the port and were fined €375,000 each. Now let's pause right there, because it says that he was found to have bribed the Togolese president, but the Togolese president is still the president today. So what is going on in that you could have someone take money in order to do something contrary to the interests of the people, and that person isn't even going to be held accountable inside of their own country? Not only that, but the people who are propping up their government and funding their government have nothing to say whenever there's corruption inside of their puppets' countries, but whenever it's inside of the countries of people who are actually trying to practice liberation, then they have everything to say about corruption and everything to say about oversight, everything to say about, hey, we need to step in and help these poor people. So this is just another instance of the hypocrisy, obviously, of Western imperialism as it plays out again. It says Bolloré's company paid $12 million fine. And the fine should have been right to the African people who were taken advantage of, the Togolese people. I'm sure that they did not receive any of that money. The judge was so shocked by what they had done in Togo that she rejected details of the plea bargain and ordered a trial of the executives. Ghana's ministerial investigation and Africa Confidential's research shows how Bolloré and his foreign partners, they persuaded the president, John Dramani Mahama, to, and this is the previous president of Ghana, to award a new container terminal contract in secret with no tender or bids in 2014, violating procurement laws. We're the people who care so much about violation of these international laws. Overstated the planned investment by a factor of two, which won tax holidays worth $832 million to an unwitting parliament. Think about how many Ghanaians could use $832 million being distributed to them. They also cut Ghana's equity in MPS to 15% after agreeing to 30%. And they reduced the fees payable to the government over the life of the concession by $4.1 billion. The terms under which the MPS operates the new terminal were gravely detrimental to the government and the people of Ghana. This is what the report says. They do not reflect honest business ethics between parties. Now, current president, Nana Akufo-Addo, as I said, he inherited this situation. This is the previous president who made this deal. While he inherited the situation, he beat Mahama in the general election of December 2016. Instead of blaming the scandal on his predecessor, he's chosen to leave the contracts as they stand while his friends and officials of the New Patriotic Party take up posts with MPS. Meaning, you know, as a new president, you come in, you find out that the previous president did something corrupt. The thing to do would be to expose the corruption, to void all contracts, to essentially say that this deal is not in our interest and we will not adhere to it. That would be the thing to do if you were being ran by the interest of your people. Not put your friends inside of positions where they're going to benefit from this corrupt deal. And I understand a lot of you love Nana Akufo-Addo because of what he says, but we have to also make sure that what someone's saying matches up to what they're actually doing. It says Akufo-Addo faced Mahama standing for the National Democratic Congress once again in 2000. December 2020's elections, the top of the timid deal did not come up in campaigning, okay? So again, if he was critical of the deal, he could have brought it up. The two men appeared to observe a pact of silence on this and several other instances of alleged bad governance and corruption. Akufo-Addo narrowly won the election. So this is the story of how the deal took place. Everyone, you could look at the full article. It will be in the description. So a few things to take away from this. Yes, we are still inside of a colonial situation. We know this. And the way that this gets practiced might not be from colonial governments necessarily coming in with guns blazing and telling our people, you have to listen to us. Instead, they send in their businessmen who come in and they make these deals with African governments. The people who are going to make money from these deals are not the masses. They are individuals. Political puppets of the West. And those billionaires take that money, and guess what? The French government's still going to get the same benefit that it would have gotten had they actually had control of Tema officially. Now, the fact that the current president has not even outed the deal, has not brought it to light, and instead seems to be enjoying the whatever benefits come with the deal on an individual basis, the fact that he has not shown his light on this does show you that we have to be very critical about what we're looking for whenever we're talking about African leaders. African leaders have to be driven by African interests and not individual interests. That's something that goes completely contrary to the colonial situation. It goes contrary to what we've been taught and ingrained into believing. We've been ingrained into believing that it's okay to give hookups whenever, you know, your friends could come in and get a few dollars inside of a deal. And meanwhile, the people don't get to see anything. But hey, you know, it wasn't my deal. We're just, you know, taking advantage of it. We've been trained to think that those things are okay as long as we pay lip service to the colonial situation. We criticize the colonial situation. But when we have different opportunities to directly impact the people who are not going to get anything by actually showing them this is what is happening that is corrupt and this is how we're going to reverse the situation, they back up because they have a benefit they're receiving. So this is how neocolonialism is able to continue, because you always have willing participants. And there will always be willing participants. That's the other thing to keep in mind. It's not a simple matter of, well, get Nana Akufo-Addo out of power, get Mahama out of power. That's not the issue. The issue has to be the system that allows these things to continue. And until the people create a system that is representative to their interests and not representative to the capitalist individual, then they're going to continue to be subjected to these types of situations. So obviously, this is another instance where you have this guy, Valore, who I've seen other articles on, I've seen other stories on, taking advantage of the chaos that exists inside of African countries for his own benefit, being a greedy capitalist, being a greedy imperialist, and of course, the French government's not going to do anything about it because this type of things benefit them directly. It's up to our people to do something about it. Our people not being the people who are elected officials, but our people being the people who are the masses, the people on the ground, the people who are the most directly affected. Once things get shown, once things get revealed, the people have to wake up and show that these things are unacceptable to them and that they will be the ones to actually call the shots over what deals are going to happen and that anything that is done is not going to be for individual enrichment, but it's going to be for the benefit of the people collectively. Those are the movement. This is the changing tide that we see coming, and I believe it's coming faster. So we just have to keep standing in solidarity, keep outing these stories, keep discussing these things, and keep organizing with our people internationally. So that's what I have on this story. I'd love to hear your thoughts, and I will see you on the next video.
Hey, family, this is Tierney Cherie. I'm here to make an announcement that I'm very, very excited to make. I'm excited because I really think this is something that is important for our people. Otherwise, I would not have devoted so much time and energy towards it. So I finished my first book, and the book title is Fostering False Identity, The Child Welfare System's Design of Social Control of the Black Family. Now, why is this book something that I think will be very important for our community? Well, number one, it's dealing with the system of white supremacy, particularly the way that the system has targeted our children. If you don't know, our children are literally our future. Without our children, we have no future. And so understand that the system is very crafty when figuring out what to derail first. And to me, it's no mistake that the system particularly went after the Black family. If you look at what happened whenever we were enslaved by this system and continues to go after Black children, continues to try to villainize African parents. So for that, I wanted to particularly talk about this subject. Now, the other thing that the book will deal with is our African identities. Why is it that our African identities are a threat to this system? Why is it that whenever we want to identify ourselves as being African, we get so much drawback inside of the Black community? I think a lot of us are not aware of the history of assimilationist thought inside of our community, this idea that we have to be close to white in order to be accepted. And so that's another subject that we delve into in this book. So I'm hoping that anyone who is, obviously, if you're a parent, a Black parent, and you really want to understand why it is that these systems are going after your children, I encourage you to read this book. I hope that it will arm you with a lot of knowledge and a lot of foresight, not just about how to protect your own children, but how to organize in your community, because that's really the purpose of the book, is to say that we have to organize among ourselves in order to protect ourselves from this white supremacist system. And then obviously, if you're an organizer in general, this is something that I think is important for you to read, because this is a subject in the Black community that we just don't discuss enough. Child welfare is not something that is going to get enough attention. People, obviously, we organize them around other causes, but this is one that is really important that I feel like we have to pay more attention to.